may require additional information. If, I don't know if the board is looking at the language I'm looking at. It just seems to read easier. I was just curious why that was changed. Steve might have an answer for that. Then two, a minor thing is throughout all these proposed sections, there's references to a four-month period and a 120-day period. I wonder if there's no reason why we couldn't have it the same one way or the other. The final is just a question. Under the subdivision sections, the planning board issues a receipt to the applicant when they first come before the board. Under the site plan ordinance, the planner does that, and I wondered if there was a history for that. I just don't know. That was it.
Steve, do you have all those questions? Maybe you can start that one at a time.
I've got some. There's no history in terms of who issues the receipt, the idea being under site plan. The process isn't quite as delineated by state law as it is under subdivision. If the board wants to issue the receipt, that's fine. The idea was that I was trying as much as possible to take that burden, take all the paperwork off the planning board, but again, it is somewhat inconsistent, so whatever works. 20 days versus 4 months, I agree. Take your pick. I guess I would like to go with, I would recommend 4 months as long as everybody understands that it's, you're dealing from regular planning board meeting to regular planning board meeting. The item coming up, dealing with the time extension, there was some concern as to whether or not 6 months meant, 30 days, or and what happened if 6 months and 3 days happened, what would occur? I don't think that's the intent of the language. If you say 120 days, you may get into the situation where that happens, where the way the calendars work, you really mean 4 months, what have you, and you run 3 days short and you're shy of your next planning board meeting. So whatever, but I agree it should be consistent.
My preference would be months, once again, for the same reason you outlined, because our meetings occur in months intervals, not necessarily days intervals. That's been my concern.
And I think maybe the first question, I think the last question, correct me if I'm wrong, regarded the placement of the language under site plan review, and there's no reason why it was that way or not. It's just something that kind of, I think, slipped under both me the first time and then Mike Hale, and it was kind of, once it slipped by once, we just kept on going and dealt with some of the more substantive. So if you want to move, I believe it was once the application is preliminarily determined, you wanted to move that up to where exactly?
I'm looking at the memo, September 14th memo from Michael Hill to you, Steve.
Mm-hmm.
On page 4 of that memo, final paragraph, maybe about 6 lines up from the bottom of that, he states, let's see, how would it work? When the town planner makes the preliminary determination that an application is complete.
Yeah.
It just sounded better that way, mm-hmm. even if you play with the wording.
Okay, does everybody, I think that makes sense. Does everybody have that?
You all have that correct memo, page 4 of the September 14th, talking about the bottom of that page.
That would make sense. It's really the last full sentence in that paragraph. When I first did it, there was some reason why it struck me to be clearer this way, but it escapes me at this point, and I don't think it was a big issue. So if the board wishes, I could insert it back along the lines of the September 14th memo. Make a general agreement? Okay, and did I hit 3 questions? Was more than 3?
The final was just the recommendation on page 2 that may be chosen over shall.
Yep, I got that.
Thank you. Any other questions on this issue?
Mr. Chairman, I have a minor point on page 4
mm-hmm.
to
of
avoid
which
the
memo now?
Of the September the 11th, October the 11th.
October
memo.
11th, okay.
In order to avoid the awkwardness of he or she, both at the top of the page and at the bottom of the page, I think you could just simply repeat the word the town or the town planner.
Okay.
Yeah.
I felt bad about that. I like to think that I try as much as anybody to avoid gender specific, and I get caught.
Yes, pretty well.
Any other questions on this? We have a proposed motion grafted related to this issue. I'll draw your attention to it. Can we, are we in a position to make a motion at this time on this?
Mr. Chairman, just before it maybe gets made, you may want to add something at the end that says that said these proposed amendments shall be revised as or shall be revised by the town planner and sent off to the tenant.
Yeah.
Prior to being submitted to the town.
The language I suggest at the end there is that the revisions would be combined to a single document and sent to the town council. But anyways, anybody want to try?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I move that it be ordered that the planning board recommends to the town council the proposed amendments to the subdivision ordinance and zoning ordinance regarding application complete list contained in the town planner's memo dated October 11, 1990, except as revised by the town attorney's comments dated October 15, 1990, as further revised in the discussion with the planning board this evening, and that the town planner be instructed to submit a completely revised version of the proposed amendments to the town council as a complete document.
Thank you. Is there a second? It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? It's passed, and I assume this will be sent on to the town council. We anxiously await their direction. Okay. Next item on our agenda is under new business. And we have a request from the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot major subdivision, request for a time extension for the submission of a final submission plan, section 16-2-4C1. As I understand it, this plan has been under review by the DEP and is at a point now where it's getting close to the six-month limit, and the applicant would like to see an extension for an additional 6 months. Mr. Butler, do you have any other background on this issue?
Not really. I think you pretty much summarized it. There's DEP approval that's still out there hanging, although it seems to be imminent. Seems like there's a hang up with the timing of the DEP, which is not unusual. In addition, I just want to point out that the applicant has some other conditions that he needs to meet before both coming out of the subdivision ordinance itself. But also from some of your conditions of approval, there's some things that he will need to do and present and have reviewed and so on and so forth before he can submit the final plan to you. So by way of background.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Maybe
Mr. Edsel.
Steve Butler can help me. We're waiting for certain documents from the DEP. Have we received anything from the developer? I mean, are we accumulating items toward the final plan, or are all the items out? I guess what I'm looking for is some type of progress report as to where the development stands.
Some progress has been made. It's been started in the past month or two. I've had ongoing discussions with the applicant. They're going through some of the conditions. I did, there's one which asks that the town planner, in essence, review the location of the easement on the southern parcel, on phase one site. Peter and I did go out on another rainy day and walked the location. I wanted to make sure that it was a pathway that once it was cleared by the applicant initially, that it would be a pedestrian trail that could be used. In essence, it was above water, you would need hip waders. And it turns out it's all on relatively dry ground. I mean, it's passable for pedestrian use. So that has been done. The applicant has asked past week and a half or so, 2 weeks, for a meeting with the department heads to start to address some of the other items that require review by the public works director, fire chief, police chief, and the town planner. In fact, we're trying to arrange something for this week, and seems it's just people's schedules and vacation times. So things perhaps were a little slow in getting started, but they're now going ahead full pace, and I'd expect once, in addition to DEP, that in the next 2 or 3 months, I would think that most of the conditions could be addressed. Again, I understand that the developer has also had some discussions with the land trust, but that's, I think, a major undertaking that's probably going to need a fair amount of time as well.
Have we received the documentation, a letter from the DEP on the actual documentation on the road itself, the access road?
Not to my knowledge. Okay. We've had some discussion. I've had discussions at least once with the staff person reviewing the project. I know the town manager has on a few occasions.
Who's the staff person?
The staff person is Linda Kokemuller. I think I'm pronouncing the name correctly. I'm sure I'm not.
I'll get that from you later.
Yeah. and so they have been reviewing it. Again, I haven't talked to her directly in the past month or two, so what I've been hearing about the progress of the application is from the from the
any developer. Indication from on the status of the groundwater quality testing to be done by the DEP?
Nothing that I've heard directly. I mean, I've heard things in the second.
Are those two items that are held up by the DEP, not necessarily by the developer?
In terms of
getting them completed within a six-month period.
For the DEP application or for another issue? The groundwater issue was something that came up as part of the DEP review process. That information has been, again, as far as I'm aware, has been prepared by the applicant, and it has either been reviewed or is being reviewed by the DEP.
Mr. Chairman, the applicant is here. Maybe we could address the questions to him rather than to Steve about what's going on.
Yeah.
Just one other question of a procedure in this that was mentioned to me by one of the abutters to the property that it would make sense to move an easement, a drainage easement, to a certain, so it doesn't border his property all the way through. That makes a lot of sense. That the contour, sure, that it would be a natural drainage ditch in another direction. Where in the process does can we make the suggestion that gets into the final plan?
I would think that, on at least one of the conditions, you've identified some changes that need to be made to the drainage plan. Within certain limits, I think it would be proper for the planning board to raise some other drainage issues. Just so you know, and the applicant may present a little bit of the details, is that it appears as though it's part of the DEP review process, an approval process, that some aspects of the plan are changing in terms of road location, full public road versus emergency access, and where the traveled ways would be or wouldn't be. So that may, in and of itself, require some changes to the plans regarding drainage, road details, and the like. So, I mean, there's a lot that's gone on since you last formally saw it, at least.
Mr. Kennedy, we have some questions that maybe you could assist us with.
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay, my question, both have to do with, the status of the DEP reporting back to us. I guess is it a matter that they are slow getting that back to us, or have you presented all the information to them?
I presented all the information to them as of July, and they have reviewed all the information, and I understand that all the interagencies have reported back to the DEP, and Linda Kokemuller is in the process of reviewing those reports and determining whether she would write an order. And that's where the DEP is now. But Linda was away for a month and basically stalled us a month. So the
purpose of your request to extend another 6 months is simply to get that?
To get DEP. I can't go forward until I have something from DEP, and to date I have nothing from DEP.
I just have a question on the timing. Is 6 months an arbitrary request, or is it just, or is it integral? We have to ask for it at this point in time. Could you ask for less, for example?
Well, I've been there's a statutory requirement with the DEP that they have a turnaround time of 105 days. Mm-hmm. They admittedly do not pay any attention to that. My project's been in since January. I've been told by the DEP that I should consider myself lucky that I might be getting through DEP in a year's time, whereas they're still considering projects of 1989. So it's beyond my control. I mean, I've been pushing and being as diligent as I possibly can. I hand carry everything over to DEP. Every report they've asked for, they've received in a timely fashion. I just can't do any more to push them without being a real nuisance. So it's very expensive for me. The cost of delay is enormous. So it's incumbent upon me to get it through as fast as I can, and that's what I'm doing.
Mr. Chairman, though, to follow up on your comment, would you be interested in a 90-day extension rather than a 6-month extension, Mr. Kennedy?
Well, I'd certainly like to be before you before 90 days, but it's beyond my control, and I'm just worried that I may not be able to meet that time frame. If I can, I will. I mean, I've been told I can, but I don't have anything in writing from DEP. The minute I get something in writing from DEP, then I can re-engineer what has to be re-engineered, or do drainage easements, whatever they require, I can jump right on it.
How much time do you think you'd need once you say you got your materials from DEP tomorrow? How much time would you need to re-engineer the project to be able to make a presentation?
2 to 3 weeks.
So you could do it within a month after that.
I would hope so, depending on what they're going to give me as conditions.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, there are going to be some other things in addition that I assume the applicant's going to be following up on in terms of some of the planning board's conditions that would also have to be done. There's some actions that the town attorney and town manager are going to have to take. So, I mean, those are going to have to be taken into account, too. I don't want the applicant to, you know, make it seem as though things can turn around overnight also. There are some other things that will have to be done, which I assume will take more than 3 weeks. I could be wrong.
Mr. Chairman, I'm dying to ask some questions, but I'd better ask one question first. Apparently, I have a brother who is trying to buy a piece of property and another brother that is trying to sell some property for Mr. Kennedy, and I've got to ask whether there are any discussions with them at this point. Are any of my relatives representing you?
No, not at this time.
All right.
And you would feel you could stay with the question?
Although it's imminent. not in Cape Elizabeth, however. Does that make a difference?
Yeah, it does. Mr. Chairman, I will abstain from any discussions on this matter while Mr. Kennedy is being represented by family members.
Okay. Then if that is the case, then I would appoint Ms. Lardner and to vote on this issue so we maintain our full complement of planning board members. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I have one comment and one question. The comment. Number two, my question is whether if we extend the time period for 6 months, if it will be 6 months from the November meeting or 6 months from this meeting?
I would assume it would be 6 months from this meeting, but Mr. Butler, maybe you can confirm that.
Just let me look at the this. I knew that was an issue that I had. I think in the motion that I, in the suggested motion that I drafted, I was actually viewing it starting from the end of the 6 month period. So when I counted and I said you know until on or before the planning board's regular May 1991 meeting. So mm-hmm. I think I was counting from November. You can count from this evening if you'd wish.
My thought would be that if we're granting an extension, it's from the time we grant the extension. But on the other hand, nothing's expired, so I...
Yeah, I mean, that was...
I don't know.
That would be more likely to be from the end of the time that it's already...
Expired. So it would be
until May.
It would be until May. Okay. I guess we have a concurrence here that it's the time when it normally would expire would then be extended 6 months. So we're kind of jumping the gun here. We actually could do this in November, but it's cutting it a little bit close.
I think my date is November 15th, and your meeting is after that.
Okay, so we have to do it now.
No, that was the whole issue of the month, 6 months, and okay. But anyway, the applicant is being extra careful and safe. So.
Okay. Any other questions on this issue? Hearing none, we have a motion drafted. It may not be exactly accurate, but I think it's close. If I could get somebody to make the motion. Okay.
Be it ordered that the planning board makes the following findings of facts and decision regarding the request of the Greater Portland Development Group for a time extension for the submission of the final plan for the Highlands of Broad Cove, the proposed 20-lot subdivision located off Channel View Road, Hunts Point Road, Winding Way, and Two Lights Road. Findings of fact. A, the applicant has received preliminary plan approval with conditions at the May 15, 1990 planning board meeting. B, section 16-2-4C1 of the subdivision ordinance requires that a final plan shall be filed within 6 months following a preliminary plan decision and states that if such application is not filed within such time period, the application shall be deemed withdrawn and shall no longer be considered a pending subdivision application unless that time limitation is otherwise extended by the planning board for good cause. C, the six-month filing period deadline will occur at the November 20th, 1990 planning board meeting. D, prior to the submission of the final plan, the applicant must obtain written evidence of the issuance of all federal, state, or local permits, meet other subdivision ordinance submission standards contained in section 16-2-4C1, and comply with several of the preliminary plan's conditions of approval. E, the applicant is waiting for a decision on the site location of development Act application from the Maine Department of Environmental Protection. F, the applicant has not met all the other subdivision ordinance submission standards contained in section 16-2-4C1 and the relevant preliminary plan conditions of approval. G, that the applicant has met the required good cause standard contained in section 16-2-4C1 of the subdivision ordinance, because the applicant is still awaiting a decision from the Maine Department of Environmental Protection regarding the applicant's site location of Development Act application. Be it therefore ordered that the request of the Greater Portland Development Group for a six-month time extension until on or before the Planning Board's regular May 1991 meeting for the submission of a final plan for the Highlands of Broad Cove, a proposed 20-lot subdivision located off Channelview Road, Hunts Point Road, Winding Way, and Two Lights Road, be granted in accordance with section 16-2-4C1 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented.
Thank you, Ms. Kane. Is there a second? You can take a deep breath now.
Second.
Any further discussion on this issue? Hearing none, I would call for a vote. All those in favor? Right hand. Opposed? I see no opposed. It's unanimous. You have a six-month extension.
Thank you very much.
Moving right along, at this time, Mr. McConnell, I could ask you, do we have a report of the Affordable Housing Subcommittee at this point in time?
Mr. Chairman, we have a tentative report, but actually I'd like to make an interim report and then
okay.
Perhaps have a final report for the next planning board meeting.
The Affordable Housing Subcommittee composed of Ivan Most, Tom Emery, and myself have been meeting with the town planner on several occasions. We've reviewed the existing zoning requirements, the comprehensive plan recommendations, the Affordable Housing Committee report, and what various communities both in the local area and outside the local area have been doing with affordable housing. Also reviewed the Thomas Jordan Trust property report. And I see that we have just received tonight from the town planner a list of comments made at the third subcommittee meeting. What we will be doing with these comments is meeting once more to see if we can actually get a proposed ordinance that we would then present to the planning board and have presumably or hopefully the planning board recommend that to the town council. And I hope we would have that at the next meeting.
Okay. Thank you. Along those lines, we probably should issue some kind of a memo to the town council about progress, since they may be asking where this is, we should probably send something along to them indicating that just about what Janet just basically said and where we stand, and that we will be submitting something to them shortly. I don't want to give them a particular date or just say shortly.
That would be up to the planning board, and I would probably use the word shortly unless you find that, set a deadline for yourself.
I would prefer to keep it that way, just in case we run into some schedule problems in getting the subcommittee together.
Mr. Chairman, just as a follow-up, one of my intents was to try and have some tentative language or proposed language possibly for this evening. It just didn't happen, but we'll see what we can come up with. Between now and the question may be in terms of the Affordable Housing Subcommittee may want to discuss and contemplate its time frame and whether or not it wants to even aim to have something for the next planning board workshop or if it wants to aim for the regular meeting.
My suggestion would be that if you can draft some language up, we're going to be talking about your tenure here pretty soon.
Mm-hmm.
If you can draft some language up and get it to the subcommittee, I don't want to preempt you, Janet,
yeah,
but if you can get that to the subcommittee, then we'd have that to look at before the workshop, and maybe that would be an item on the workshop.
Okay.
Thank you, Janet. We're through with all our regular business on our agenda. We do have some other business that's going to come before us. I'd like to, before I call on Steve to introduce one of those items, I've got one or two items that I could just bring to your attention. There will be a town council meeting on November 12th, I believe. That's a Monday night. I will not be able to attend it because I will be out of town. What will be coming before the committee at that time will be a sign ordinance, change to the town sign ordinance. I'm really sorry I can't make that because I have an interest in how that goes, but it would be very helpful if a member of the planning board could be at that meeting. I have received a draft ordinance on signs, which I could give to Steve to be transmitted over to a member who could attend that meeting that night. We are looking at improving our downtown area. We are looking at trying to get some consistency in signs. This is the ordinance that can help have that, make that happen. So I guess what I would ask is if somebody can make that meeting, make their presence known to me, and we'll try to get this in your hands so that you could...
Mr. Chairman, I would think that you'd want the vice chairman to be there.
Mr. Esler,
thank you, Mr. Tinsman. I'll attend.
Okay, I have the ordinance draft here, and maybe Steve can make sure that you have a copy of it. Steve, you had an item that's come before your come to your attention that you would like to bring to our attention.
Yes, and again, I'm aware of the fact that two of the members were abstained in this item. It regards the Zorsky-Thibodeau public access waiver that was granted with some conditions at the August 1990 meeting. But if what you could do would perhaps take out the first four pages of the minutes that in terms of what was approved at the beginning of tonight's meeting for the August 21st meeting. And I also submitted before you this evening a very short memo talking about at least two of the issues that the applicants would like to raise. And then added on to that was a letter from Bob Hunter, the town's engineer, that kind of precipitated some of the items that are coming before for you tonight. Having talked with just in terms of the process, what the applicants are asking for is some clarification on some of the conditions of approval. Having viewed the videotape of that meeting, I have to admit it wasn't crystal clear in terms of what happened that evening. Part of it was the setting of the meeting, and part of it was just the difficulty I think some of the board was having in grappling with all the different details. It was a difficult decision. The planning board chairman has suggested that we talk about or perhaps that the board might want to just focus on having the planning board see if they want to reconsider or clarify these points and maybe others that the applicant has, and whether or not that should actually then happen, the actual clarification should happen at the November meeting, once everybody's had a chance to contemplate, review, what have you, or if that's something that would want to be happened this evening. So, by way of background, that's kind of where we've been up to this point. I gave you an update at the last meeting. The two major issues, and again, they're right there in that memo, there are several conditions that the planning board put on the public access waiver. I won't go into a lot of detail at this point, but one of the conditions was that the site distance be extended in both directions. You're looking for a site distance of 350 feet or an adequate site distance, that the information that was presented by the applicant's engineer be put on a plan and submitted to the town engineer for his review and comment. That was done. I worked with the applicants, and we kind of worked out, you know, kind of hashed through what we all thought the various conditions meant. The applicant's engineer did submit a plan and the letter to Bob Hunter. Bob Hunter came back with this letter that you have before you to raise some concerns and questions. And that's where the two items that I indicated on the memo come out from. One is what site distance standard should be used, and secondly, did the planning board mean to or intend to leave open the possibility that the town engineer would have some concerns about the location of some of the site modifications to a degree that he would be requesting a land survey? Are there any questions at this point? I think I'm going to stop.
Mr. Chairman, I've got a couple. What's the difference in standards between subdivision and public access waiver?
Okay. It's I haven't memorized those two, but I think it's the distance in terms of the object on the ground, and I can look. It's the 2-inch versus the 4-inch standard, and I'd have to go back and look in detail and see what the difference is. Turns out that there is a difference, and it turns out that the subdivision standard is stricter. In other words, it would be more difficult for the applicant to meet. It doesn't mean it's impossible. We don't know, but it would be stricter.
Weren't we issuing a public access waiver?
You were, and that's where some of the confusion came up. However, given the fact that this public access waiver roadway served three or more lots, the ordinance says you have to be then bumped over to the subdivision standards, but then the board can waive any and all of those standards. That's the situation where you were. You were bounced over to the subdivision ordinance standards, you waived, you had the findings of fact that caused you to, or gave you reason and cause to waive those standards. And when you talked about site distance, you didn't reference one or the other. So that's the question. Bob Hunter thought, you know, follow through the process and kind of, he followed the logic to a degree and said, they're using subdivision, they waived some. He went to the subdivision center and said, they didn't use that standard and should, and so on and so forth. Had some comments about site distance using either standard, but wanted the applicants to use the stricter subdivision standards.
Well, I guess, Mr. Chairman, I don't want to take up all of the questions because I'm sure there are others who have some, but I'm not sure I understand what the issue really is, how much of a discrepancy there is between what can be achieved given public access as opposed to subdivision standards. And T.Y. Lynn's letter talks about a 4-foot height. And is that 4 foot?
Yeah, 4 feet. Yeah, sorry, okay. Not 4 inches.
and what that means in terms of distance. When you worked with the applicant and putting that together, did you use the public access waiver standard or the subdivision standard waiver?
It didn't get by that point. I mean, their engineer used in their letter, it was advanced engineering, use the public access waiver standard and
achieve the 350 feet looking west.
I think they went a little bit over. I believe so. I'd have to check that letter. but I believe they did. They met the standard or thought they could meet the standard that was being required.
Mr. Chairman, it just seems that we had one applicant come in and ask for a public access waiver, and that evening we required them to meet certain conditions, and only those conditions, and maybe it was a little fuzzy whether it was subdivision standard or public access waiver standard, but I would think that they weren't in for subdivision approval. They were into a situation where there was more than two or three lots that were being served by a road, but they were essentially in for one public access waiver for that particular lot, and to hold them to the same standard as a subdivider, as a developer coming in, I would think would be tough, only from the standpoint, not only for this, but there are a lot of private roads in our community that have lots on them that could require public access waivers, and if we start applying the subdivision standard to all of those, that would be I think we'd have a tough sledding. I'm not sure what the difference is, but if the public access waiver is good enough for our public access waiver, then it should be good enough for this particular application, regardless of how many properties are being served by the road. Only one's asking for permission to build a house and come out on it.
So our suggestion is that we clarify the issue to the point that we would be considering this the conditions on a public access waiver, not subdivision.
That's my suggestion.
Any other suggestions, Alan? To clarify the site distance question, first of all. Let's take them one at a time. Well?
Let's see, Ben. We've got... Surely there's a small number of you that... Well, actually, there's more than I think.
Mr. Chairman, just to make it official, yeah. Probably at this time, as we did before, yes. I'll refrain from any discussion or voting in this matter.
Then I would appoint Mr. Emery to vote in this case.
And I'll be refraining as well.
I'll appoint Ms. Lardner. We're still at full compliment. Dropping like flies here.
Picking them up.
So the issue with... question may be regarding Ms. Lardner in terms of if the idea is to clarify the intent for not having been there.
Yeah.
I mean, it may not be appropriate, and I don't know. But anyway.
You can vote, but good luck.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So I guess on a question one in your memo, which standard should be applied, it's Mr. Tinsman suggesting be the public access waiver. I guess we should probably put this in the form of a motion and vote on it so we keep it clear.
Is that necessary?
I would say so at this point, just so we don't have more fuzziness.
Okay, can we deal with the second question,
sure.
too, and then have just one clean motion? Land survey, why is the town engineer suggesting the land survey? Is that for the site distance issue or for the road going into the property?
It's for the site distance issue. There's a lot of clearing that needs to be done either way. Whatever standard is being used, and he feels that it's very unclear regarding what would have to be removed within the right-of-way versus what potentially could be on abutting property owners. Feels the board and the applicant's relying a lot on the fact that the roads, you know, you're using the center line and that the right-of-way is indeed there. So when he went out on the site, he felt that, that he would feel much more comfortable if everybody knew on the town side and his side as an engineer that everybody knew where things were. So the town wasn't in effect recommending removal of objects that might be on private property.
Mr. Chairman, our motion, as I remember and as I've read this evening, indicates that they have to show how they're going to achieve the 350-foot site distance.
That's correct.
From the intersection, and if the town engineer is not satisfied with how they're proposing to do it, then they haven't satisfied the town engineer, and whatever means are required to satisfy the town engineer that 350 feet can be achieved as should be. I'm almost reluctant to say that has to be done by a registered land surveyor as a planning board. I think that's up to the engineer and the applicant to work out, and the applicant to prove to the engineer that it can be done.
Okay. I think that just reinforces item C, which is asterisk, that we are looking for the town engineer's comments and direction in this issue. So I think I don't want to put words in your mouth, but what you're saying is that stands, basically, as it was originally intended.
The burden is on the applicant to prove it, however that's required.
And the town engineer has given some direction here on how that can be done. So really, I guess we only have one item to vote on here.
Mr. Chairman, maybe before, I just want to point out that one of the applicants is here. Just point that out for your information, and I'm not sure where you want to go with that. Don't know if he has comments or if you want to entertain comments, but just want to raise that fact to the board.
I think if he had comments, he'd be at the microphone.
Yeah, at this point, I think the conditions are fairly clear, and I think we can probably make a decision one way or the other. Now, Mr. Zorsky,
I do have comments. I thought I would be asked to speak if that was indicated. I didn't know that I should be aggressive about it.
Mr. Chairman, do we have to do anything about suspending rules and taking up an item out of order or any of that stuff?
The problem here is that we've already acted on something. This is we're not going back to another review of your situation all over again. I guess I could entertain a question that you might have on the rules as we're taking them up right now, but I really can't entertain a whole review of your application at this point in time.
Okay.
It's just not possible.
Well, I'm not asking for that.
Okay.
I did have one other issue that we wanted to clarify that isn't in this memo from Steve Butler. Would that be appropriate to?
You can mention it.
Okay, that concerns getting the approval of people that live on that road in terms of this declaration for how the road will be maintained. Mm-hmm. And we're having difficulty so far getting a hold of one of the people on that road. And I'm wondering if the town can give me ideas on what we should do if we can't get a hold of this person. It seems that we might, after all these meetings and stuff that we've been through and legal work and engineers and stuff, we may eventually be held up by one person on the road not being open to discussion of the issue in terms of keeping the width of that road clear and open.
Well, all I can say is that was one of the conditions that we placed on the approval. If you are at the point now where you're saying you can't satisfy that condition, then I guess you would have to take some formal action, and here I would ask you to get some advice on how to do this. I can't give you that advice to get this condition changed. I don't think it can be done by just a request at this meeting tonight.
Okay.
Because we do have conditions that we have passed on your public access waiver. I think you're asking for a waiver of that, and I think that's going to come back to us in some form or fashion.
I think if it goes beyond the point of clarification, which I think at least the first item pertains to, then a course of action could be for the applicant to come back and request one or more of the conditions of approval to be amended.
Okay.
With the reasons.
With the reasons.
More reasons, yeah. Because you're asking for relief from a condition that's not unclear. I mean, I think it was quite clear.
Okay.
So I think here you're asking for relief, and I think you'd have to do that in a formal fashion.
Okay, yep.
Thanks. Any other questions on this?
Mr. Chairman, you were looking for a motion.
On item number one, to clarify one only.
I think first, I'm not sure, but it doesn't hurt to do it, so I would make a motion. We suspend the rules to take up an item out of order, which deals with a clarification of which standard would be applied to this applicant, the subdivision standard or the public access waiver standard. That is the first motion to get it onto the table.
Right.
Second.
Is there any discussion on a motion to suspend the rules? All those in favor? Opposed? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I'd make a motion that we clarify the issue of measuring site distance by for this applicant by indicating that it is the public access waiver measurement standard found in section 19.4.2b.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
any discussion at this point?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would like to be relieved. I don't think I can vote intelligently on this.
Your abstention is noted. All those in favor? Opposed. At least we can clarify one point for you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, just for the record, it should be pointed out that the applicants have been very diligent in meeting, trying to meet the conditions, and they came for the, you know, me and asked this to be put on because there seemed to be a true question.
Good.
Just want to get that on. Okay.
One other item before we adjourn. I did receive a note from the town manager just this evening, so I don't know how we can deal with it, related to an issue that is coming before the town council for a health fitness facility in the BA zone. Let me just read the letter. I'm not sure everybody received it. Maybe they did. Town council has referred to the planning board the attached request for amendment to the zoning ordinance. Proposal would, if enacted, permit health fitness facilities in the BA zone. I note the proposal does not define health fitness facility. The town council would appreciate a recommendation from the planning board in accordance with the amendment procedure of the zoning ordinance. I don't see how we can act on this tonight. My recommendation is that we have our planner take a look at this issue and possibly either be able to make a presentation at our workshop in November or, if it's appropriate, at our meeting in November on this issue. So I would remand this one to staff for review at this point in time.
And just to clarify, I did meet with one of the persons who was kind of the initiator of this ordinance change, Tom Tinsman, today, and we were all aiming towards the November meeting, so he will be submitting materials in support of this. I'm sure that the town planner will be providing follow-up information.
Great. I guess at this point,
keep it to just those two items, the Highlands and this one, I won't have to attend.
That's right. You can just stay home and watch.
Stay home and watch.
I'm not sure you're going to be able to do that.
Okay. Are there any other items coming
before? Mr. Chairman, I just had a quick one. I may have missed something, but did we take any action on our September 18th minutes? I know we adopted our August minutes, but did we do the September?
We did those first.
We did those first.
Fine.
You came in a little late.
You came in a little. Yeah. Those were passed.
Mr. Chairman, if there's no other information or material to be submitted, before you get to go home and see the ball game, I'd just like to state that this is my last official meeting as a town planner starting Monday. I'm the new town planner, full-time planner. Maureen O'Mara will start, and I know you're going to be very happy with her. But before I go, I just do happen to have a few gifts for the planning board.
I don't think this should be.
I was planning on getting into this after the meeting.
Ah, okay. Okay. We can cancel the meeting.
I did request that the planning board members stay around for something afterwards. I think they hopefully all received it in their mail. Nope. So if I could at this point in time entertain a motion to adjourn.
Could I entertain? No, I would never do that.
Could I entertain a motion to adjourn?
I so move. Second.
Second. Okay, all those in favor? We are adjourned, and now we can get into what I'd like to do is also make a presentation. But let's let Steve do his first, seeing that he's requested that. Yeah, then maybe I may not want to do mine.
Yeah. At the party house.
Darn, yeah, maybe I should wait to mine for a second. Okay, I'm sure. But, okay, I do have a few gifts. They're very solemn gifts.